Good evening. Welcome to tonight's planning board meeting on November 20th, 2008. We're going to, I think this microphone isn't working. Welcome to tonight's meeting, November 20th, 2008. We're going to, the 6:30 work session is on the zoning rewrite, and I'm going to hand it over to Rick.
Okay, thank you. We're continuing. We only have an hour to work on this tonight. We're continuing the discussion of the signs from last week's work session. And I believe that we are just about finished getting to the end of the illumination section. So I think we're on page 11 of the handout we were working on last week. So 10's the last page I actually have notes on. So I assume that if we looked at a page, I'm sure I would have had notes on it. So if we can just jump in on this, and you have to. You think we've gone through the internal illumination?
I think we got to additional sign regulations.
Okay, good.
Do other people think that on page 12?
Yes.
It's close. Yeah, maybe we do. I know the last note that I have is just looking at all aspects of sign lighting, just taking another look at it. So maybe we just need to we're just skipping ahead. So. Okay, page 12, additional sign regulations. And this was an attempt to try to get at some of the issues of having buildings that have facades on more than one street, or that are visible, that may not have a facade facing a street, but have a facade that's visible from a street. So if they're part of a shopping center, or is shown on the right-hand side of figure 7, a series of businesses that are linked together in one building, and only one building actually has frontage on the main street. So that was basically the attempt to have to try to allow more flexibility there in terms of signage, and not just require signs to be on the side of the building facing the street.
5 seconds.
And then the next part on the top of page 13, we talked about briefly in terms of moving the provisions for upper floor signs into the up further to the beginning of the ordinance in terms of have it where the other sign area regulations are, and we wanted to look a little bit more at that and talk about whether the area of projecting signs was the provision for having them all on the single bracket and so forth was appropriate. I don't know if anybody had any questions or further comments about those, either of those first two sections.
Just want to, is there a distinguished, if there's a piece of property between that business and the right of way, or a low-lying property or wetlands?
I'm sorry, what is I wasn't sure what your question.
You're allowing another sign area on the building. If for example, if something was along, a building was along Route 16, and there was a wetland separating it, the property from Route 16, so it wasn't directly abutting the road, but it's clear that they could be visible. Is that an allowed, do they get the additional benefit in this case here?
Could you say that again, Tony?
Well, for example, along Route 16, you had a building that the frontage of the building was on the other side. But the back of the building had a visible area off of 16, but was separated by a parcel of land. It would be at a wetland where it was plainly a view of the back of the building, and they would like to put a sign up. But I'm just trying to think of an example where I don't know if that needs to be addressed or should be addressed, or am I reaching it?
Well, I think, I mean, it's, even if the wetland isn't there, I think you raise a good point that the ordinance is designed to address signs that are visible from the frontage, the building's frontage, but there are other cases where you would have signs that are, where the building might not be facing, you might want to have the building have signage facing on a major limited access highway in that situation. And I'm not sure how that is done right now. How is that handled right now?
We had that issue come up with Home Depot. Mm-hmm. I think we used the shopping center criteria so they could split the signage up, and they did it between the frontages.
I'm not sure.
Malcolm McNeil was working closely with Roger on that one, and that's the most recent one, and perhaps we can take a look at that.
Okay. What about the, now, what this provision here says is that the, you can have signs on multiple sides of a building up to the maximum sign area for the business. Now, would, in a situation like this where you might have a business that was, had an access from Woodbury Avenue and visibility from Route 16, would you want to still, I mean, if you're dividing the signage, they're still dividing the signage, then you're, each of those signs is going to be fairly, is going to be smaller than if they only had one sign, which is reasonable. But I guess, is that what you would, what you think is a reasonable approach to take in terms of, in terms of that? Does anybody have thoughts on that?
Well, I think it is reasonable to do that. It's parallel to the one below it. And then if, in a case like that, they would go to the Board of Adjustment, right, for a unique circumstance.
Okay.
Certainly if they wanted Christmas more.
If they wanted more.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
And Lucy, what relief did Christmas Tree get?
They were given relief for attached signage greater than they would have been allowed, and I believe aggregate probably would go mm-hmm. along with that, because they have signs facing their parking lot, facing the side of the building where one of the entrances is, mm-hmm. that corner entrance, and also from the turnpike, mm-hmm. which you would not see from any other part mm-hmm. except on the highway.
Yeah.
So is the best way to deal with that in zoning, or to let them go to the Board of Adjustment, because it doesn't come up that often?
It doesn't come up that often. I imagine that there are probably relatively few parcels that, that comes up with. I mean, you'd have a few on 95, like around the hospital, that area. And you'd have, and on the other side, the by the Marriott,
and then I think the Home Depot one worked out. I think that'd be a good one to see how that
yeah,
one
okay.
was.
Yeah. Okay. So look at that one. Yeah.
I don't remember.
Well,
no, we did it.
And here's what I'm worried about. Why I wouldn't want to expand it. If you think of the multi-use ideas that we've talked about for Route 1, which would be businesses and residential, you know, and if we've talked about kind of the different sorts of layouts for those, where you might have a street going through it, potentially a building in there would have all four sides that you're talking about. And I think what we don't want to do is to, it would, it might have a public entrance or an entrance that's inside and then a sidewall like facing Route 1. Well, we don't want to just junk up close-in stuff Route 1 and just make it all signs. Mm. Even if it's multi-use. So I would say this is a better way to keep it. Route 16 is one thing, but Route 1 is another.
Okay. Yes.
In point 10, a separate use with more than one exterior wall, I'm hung up on the separate use. Do you mean just a use with more than one? I'm trying to understand separate. Or I'm missing something?
No, no. I think that you're not missing anything. I think that the maybe just a use by itself works. I think it meant to be a you know a use in a multi-use building or something like that. Or maybe it isn't even that. It maybe it's a separate. You need the word separate.
Yeah, you do. Yeah.
The same general. We're trying to regulate this building that has multiple sides that could have signage. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay.
And actually, the illustration, which it says Figure 6, it should be Figure 7, obviously. And the illustration was changed after the provision was written. Unfortunately, we were trying to address too many things in the same illustration. So originally, where the left lot is on that illustration was another street coming down. So it were two sides of that building facing two different streets.
Okay.
So we need to, and then we tried to show something else, and then so it got confusing. So we'll try to get a clearer illustration for you to make it work. Part of this whole the challenge is, you know, when you have these special situations, is actually having a good illustration that tells you what it is you're talking about. I think that one of the, on the top of page 13, the very first provision, the, one of the things that should have gone in here is a non-illuminated sign, I think. It's, if this is, it's not visible from right-of-way, but if it's visible from an adjacent lot, it might be an issue to have it illuminated. So we thought that we might want to look at that. It's not in all cases, because it may not matter if the sign is facing a business district, but if it's facing a residential district, it could be a problem.
And should there be a limit of the size? I think it's a great idea. I'm just curious of whether we should still cap it.
Okay.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, you might.
Yeah.
4x8 size.
It could be.
Yeah.
Could get.
You know, one of the things, I'm coming back to the idea of letter height. I've been doing some more looking into that. One of the things that we had in the earlier one for the for exempting things that had less than 3 inches, and I did some more research, and the numbers that I think I found is that a three quarter inches is readable up to 20 feet, and then, you know, an inch and a half is readable up to 50 feet or something like that, or 2 inches is readable to 50 feet. So we may want to even here say, you know, these are the ones, we don't want to have these be advertising signs, but these are kind of instructional signs. Here's, you know, $5 for the platinum car wash special, or you know, put your trash here or something like that. So that's really what these signs tend to be, what we're talking about, I think, or drive in here. So we may want to, you know, maybe put a letter height in there, and as well as a sign, overall sign area height.
That's a good idea, because people get creative and say, oh, that's my menu board.
Right. Okay. Anything else on either, and we definitely need to do some more work on that. Is there anything, we had a discussion about the above the ground floor signs last time. Is there any further discussion about that?
Again, similar to what Rick was asking before, the per use, is that per business or per tenant?
Yeah, really, perhaps per establishment. I'm not. We need to figure out how to do that. It's not. It's. We don't want to have one space have five different uses in it and count five different signs.
That could happen.
Yeah.
Well, the diagram uses the term business, right? So for the
yeah,
text to match the diagram,
business,
it would have to be business.
Well, for an example, I'm in a building with that rents office space. We've shared business uses like conference rooms.
Yep.
There's probably, there could be 75 businesses in this building. Don't want 75 4-foot square signs.
We'll look at that. I'll control that better.
13. Well, I guess we'd have the aggregate area that would bump into.
Yeah.
In point two, what do we feel, what's everyone feel concerning this mounting on a single bracket? It's currently what it is. Is that a good idea or not so good idea?
Not a good idea.
I'm wondering its need.
Yeah. Why don't you explain your experience?
Well,
it doesn't work.
It really doesn't work, but then on the flip side of that, as someone just said, if you had 75 uses, and that might be a stretch. You know, do you want 75 brackets around the building too? So, I don't know that I think that the single bracket serves people well. But by the same token, I'm not sure if we just take it out, and then that opens up an unlimited amount of bracket. Although, is there a cap? There's a cap on the maximum amount still.
Maximum overall sign area,
So that we get it that way. And that would just be included in that aggregate. See, now those signs above the first floor are not included in the aggregate. But then they're limited to only 2 square feet. And on a single bracket, so there's really not many you can do.
Is 4 square feet a more reasonable height for those? In this area for those?
2x2. 2x2, yeah. I do.
And so eliminate the single bracket, we think, perhaps, and they take a look at that and see whether we talk about spacing.
Yeah. John, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I think I don't know that I've spotted another contextual error here or not, but in sign on 1072.1, when you talk about a wall sign will not exceed 4 square feet in use, you're talking about sign district 2, and yet I look at the chart and it says 100 square feet.
That was the confusion we had before, because the chart was really meant to be kind of the maximum, right, on anywhere in the building, but then we're saying above the ground floor it was limited to 4. So that was and I actually, from the last meeting, I've crossed out 100 here. So we need to just clarify what is a general requirement, and then within that general requirement, what is the requirement for, mm-hmm, for above the ground floor versus above the ground floor.
I see what you're saying, yep.
So isn't 100 aggregate?
Not the aggregate.
100 what we had left was a 200 aggregate, and we also had 100 for a wall sign, and we'd crossed out, we thought 100 was too big last time for the individual wall sign.
Okay.
So we need to look at that, but we had left the 200 as the aggregate.
Okay. I was looking at that one.
Do you have a question, Chris?
Yeah, point three. Is the intention of this is if you choose for your property to do a freestanding sign, then you can't do above second floor signs. Is that what that's supposed to mean?
I think that there's a maximum aggregate sign area, again, for all signs on a lot, and you could do wall signs or freestanding signs or a combination of them. But you can't do multiple freestanding signs for a particular building. In this regard, though, I'd like to ask, you know, whether we think that, are there examples of freestanding signs in the central business or any of these? I guess there are some in the MRO and MRB, like
Vaughan
in front
Mall.
Yards. What's that?
The Vaughan Mall.
Vaughan Mall. Okay.
That doesn't make sense.
But, okay, so this says a freestanding sign should include all the uses above the ground floor. That means that you couldn't have a small second floor sign and a freestanding sign.
That actually wasn't the intent. It should be clear in that. It was really meant to say that you couldn't have. My understanding is it was meant to say you couldn't have multiple freestanding signs on a lot.
Should we say that?
Well, you can't have multiple freestanding signs
on a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. Generally, you would only have one, because otherwise you're decreasing your visibility. It gets harder to regulate it. The idea was to concentrate at one spot.
I'm just thinking of the property on Maplewood. The Department of Health and Human Services, I think, is in most of the building. The one,
mm-hmm,
on,
yeah,
that seems to have. Is that?
It could.
May have more, but you just want. We're saying we want only one now.
You know, also, I don't know if that was getting closer to a monument sign too. So you got those distinctions.
Are we going to distinguish that? I mean, saying.
I think we're trying to.
That's coming.
We're
up
saying
next.
One you can have more of, and
no. Generally, they have a board some places where you walk in. One is the central business district, which is a little bit unique. Yeah. The freestanding sign is more what I would picture at a mall.
Yeah.
But you can have them downtown, and I think you're hitting something that we have to be careful in our definition to make sure we do those. But generally, you don't have more than one.
Okay. And a separate issue, going back to Rick's brackets, I think because you could divide 4 into 200 a lot, I think maybe we should have the number of brackets be based upon street frontage. I don't think we want.
Reasonable. I don't know what the number would be, but.
Yeah.
You know, it would be helpful is if somehow we could get the brackets down if the signs go.
I'll all the brackets that hang around after the business is gone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But they get reused.
Yeah. You're so much nicer than the signs. I don't know why you want to take them down.
Just and paint you them. Just keep on making scars in the building. So, you know, if it's there, it's there.
It's character.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, shopping centers. This is a separate section in your current ordinance. I've tried to simplify it by essentially removing a distinction between different size shopping centers. There are two sets of regulations in the current ordinance. So the first provision is just saying what kinds of signs you can have. You can have freestanding signs, wall signs, and monument signs. And again, this one thing that we noted last time is we had defined, but we hadn't actually made provisions for awning signs. And I think that's probably something we should add in here, because awning signs are add a lot to a row of buildings. And then it allows what kinds of signs you can have. And one of the odd things about the ordinance, which Rick and I were talking about today, is the provision for monument signs, because it seems that, and we may be missing it, but it seems that the current ordinance, we think, and this proposed rewrite, the only provision for monument signs really has to do with shopping centers. I think we may have tried to bring it back here. We allow them in other areas, but we don't make regulations for them necessarily in other areas. So there's a very strong, there's much more specificity for shopping centers. We just need to look more carefully at that. And it only allows monument signs in the shopping center for a freestanding building in the shopping center. So you couldn't, and again, a monument sign, we're going to look at some pictures of monument signs and pole signs in a little bit, but the monument sign under the ordinance is a low sign that is, let's have it over here.
Definition.
It's not higher than 6 feet from the average grade in the shopping center. So it's a big slab, essentially, continuous from the top of the sign to the ground, as opposed to a pole sign or other freestanding signs which have some kind of support holding them up. So the way the ordinance has been written up till now is that those are only, in the shopping center, they only seem to be available for a freestanding building. So you couldn't have that at the entrance, for example, a nice solid monument sign. Your freestanding sign would have to be a pole sign. So one of the things that we might want to look at is the possibility of expanding that to basically allow monument signs as one of the basic signs for all buildings in the shopping center, or for all parts of a shopping center, for the shopping center as a whole, as well as for industrial parks and so forth. Does anybody have any feelings about monument signs versus pole signs? Do you have a sense of what we're talking about?
Just a commentary. It's confusing when you say a monument sign. I would think of something like the former Jokin's Thar She Blows sign. But under your definition, that's not a monument sign.
No.
That's a
freestanding pole
sign.
Pole
sign?
Yeah. When you think about a monument sign, think about...
Get that one wrong.
Think about a monument maker who's somebody who makes gravestones, you know, and it's that kind of shape of, you know, typically that kind of shape is that monument, that kind of big slab. Mm.
And like the library.
Like the library sign. Yeah.
Is that a monument sign? Because it has this little thing that holds it up.
The library?
Yeah.
I don't know. It has poles on it? Yeah.
Well, that's where I was getting at. I don't want to rehash something we already talked about, but I think we have to be clear that we have a definition that just because they come up off the ground 6 inches and have two poles, that it's no longer into a different section of the ordinance under freestanding sign because they put these token poles in to beat the ordinance. But
because there is no definition of poles.
Yeah, the question is, are they beating the ordinance? I mean, the regulations on monument signs are stricter than they are for freestanding signs.
That's my point, is that they want a monument sign, so they put a couple poles in. Mm. And they say that we're a freestanding sign because we have these.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well,
we raise it off the ground 6 inches. Mm-hmm.
That's a whole different. Yeah, you know, that's. I'm going to pass these out.
I mean,
it's
most,
time to pass these out.
Most monument signs that I'm thinking of are probably, by our definition, freestanding pole signs.
This is your homework. Yeah. Right. This is your homework. We need visual aids.
You do.
This doesn't get to your question, but it gets to another aspect of your question. I hope there are enough to go around.
It's a quiz.
Well, the Walmart one at the bottom. It's similar to my question. Mm-hmm.
So this comes down to the, you know, question of what is a monument sign versus a pole sign. And in your current regulations, and this is typically the way most ordinances are written, a monument sign is a low sign that is... that is solid from the top of the sign down to the ground. There's kind of no distinction between the support and the sign itself. And yeah it's Macon, Georgia.
really?
Yeah. as opposed to, you know, something that actually has a structural support. And typically, monument signs have, you know, are limited to, as your ordinance is, 6 or sometimes 10 feet or something like that. But it's sort of the difference between something that you're driving along and it's sort of the words are at your height as you're driving along. You're sort of looking straight at them as opposed to looking up. And they're meant to grab you as you go by the entrance versus grabbing you from a long distance. And what's happening now, as we're seeing, is this new type of sign, which is, we would call it a monument sign, except it's 20 or 25 feet tall, like the Fiat and the Toyota and so forth. And then there are these kind of hybrids, like this Nissan sign down in the lower left, which is almost a monument sign. It's, you know, it's effectively has the same, you know, it blocks light, is continuous really up to the top, but it does have, it has legs, it has, you know, stripes, so there's a different kind of sign area. It expands the what the sign area is. And then you look at, then there, you get halfway in between, on the second page is the Texaco sign, which is a, you know, somewhat older fashion. It's a pole sign, but the components of the sign are getting closer and closer to the ground. So one of the things that we have to think about is what we, it's, you know, part of this is aesthetic, and part of it is controlling the scale of advertising, and it's that whole discussion we had before about stripes and colors and, you know, how big the sign area is. And so if you were looking, for example, at these Nissan signs, the sign area, you would probably include the whole sign in the sign area because there is a distinctive pattern and stripe that gets the whole sign area. But you might not do it with a Toyota sign because the Toyota sign is, you know, the sign area is kind of limited. So it's one of these things that we have to think about. And it gets even more complicated because, you know, I happen to like the sign on the lower right-hand corner, the Raleigh Springs Mall sign. I think that's kind of a cool sign. It's got, but, you know, how is that different from the Walmart sign or the Consumer Square sign, you know, other than the aesthetics of it? Yeah, other than less ugly, right, yes.
Rick thinks it's cool.
Right. I mean, the whole sign is involves color and everything like that, and it's and they're both very similar in terms of having thick pole supports.
I always think things are simple, then I ask you guys, and I realize why they're not so simple. I mean, our issue is traffic on the monument signs. We're worried about visibility and sight lines, right?
Well, it could be, except that if you had it forced it to be set back 20 feet from the street, you know, then it wouldn't be an issue. So
I wonder. Here's my naive, simple definition: is why don't we have call it a monument sign if it's below 8 feet, and a freestanding sign above that, and freestanding signs from 8 feet down have to be a certain thinness.
Well, you know, it actually, or you could look at it a different way. Now that you bring that up, we could kind of throw out the whole, try not to make the distinction anymore, and just say, a low sign and a high sign, and have different regulations for different types of signs, I suppose, different heights of signs. I guess the kind of general issue is that these big monument signs, which are even called by their manufacturers pylon signs, which I've always thought of as a pole sign, but they're calling this the Fiat and the Toyota, they're calling those pylon signs, and they are the wave of the present, you know, right now. So this is where signs are going. So you're going to be seeing more of these as they come in, and the question is, how do we want to deal with them? Do we want to basically allow them? Do we want to allow this type of sign? And if so, then how do we deal with sign? How should we address this in terms of changing our regulations of sign area?
If we follow Tony's logic and we do a certain height, 5 feet and shorter as a monument mm-hmm. sign, do we then say those need to be X amount of feet off your right of way and anything above that? I mean, it makes it real simple if we can make it work that way.
That sounds good.
I mean, it just seems like it takes, you know, you're putting it up on 1 foot legs. Is that?
So regulate setbacks, sign area.
Just a thought. Yeah. I always think enforceability. How do you enforce this? How can people try to slight? Chris?
I like the direction we're going in. I just want to make sure that we're not encouraging pylons by doing that. So that I don't want to make it easier to do. You know, I'm having a real hard time finding. I was hoping that the quiz wasn't like which is the one that we want. So, because I don't think we want really any of these.
But that's what they all really are.
I know. So that's what I'm saying. So the monument sign idea I like. I like the just, you know, the dimensionality of it. But by requiring a certain setback for it, I don't want to put, we need to regulate the other kind so we don't push people in that direction of these big things with legs.
Tony?
Is this sign area subtracted off the total sign area, or is it separate?
It would be subtracted off the total sign area.
It's regulated. You have so much you can use for this, but then you still have a property maximum.
Right. What I was getting at is perhaps we should tie the two together, and so to discourage pylon signs, if they want the pylon sign, they're taking off their building.
But the pylon's the whole sign.
Okay, that's
it is. But to pick up your Toyota example, we define the pylon as the we define the sign area as the entire pylon, so that it's not just like the top third of that.
I guess that was my initial impact. But when you compare the Fiat to the consumer square, and if you were to be compare Toyota to Consumer Square. That's an easier one. So the Toyota one is you're looking at the entire sign and you're looking at the entire Consumer Square sign. In some ways, if you were to include the sign area of the Toyota sign, you know, the area that includes the logo and the names, then you would be kind of encouraging something to be more like Toyota and less like Consumer Square because there's so much more sign area there. So that's another thing you're looking at is. What are the comparisons? What are somebody's choices? And if you're gonna count the whole sign area anyway, they might as well just fill it up with words.
Isn't what's uniformly ugly about all of these is they're so tall? You know, I mean, and we always get into that issue of where do you end and begin measurement of the sign. Mm-hmm. If we limited everything, not just the monument signs, to they can't be over X number of feet, and I don't know what that magic number is. Then that's going to limit the number of words. You couldn't do the consumer square mm-hmm. sign
yep.
because you wouldn't do it in teeny tiny
yep.
font. When I look at these, I mean, the only one that's halfway decent looking to me is the Carnegie Center, and that's only because
exactly.
it's relatively small and it's tied to a building, so it has that scale right. of the building. But I would agree that the Raleigh Springs one might be somewhat less.
You're just doing that to me.
But if you look at, like, on the last page, the Walden Crossings, that's unbelievably ugly, even though it does not yet have that many words on it.
All of these say Las Vegas, property for lease, decline, empty, oil bust. I mean, you just look at it, and they all connote that to me. It's all like a place that's going down the tubes.
I think shorter is better. I think that's a good one.
But I think if we go with what we were talking about, the tall signs have to be pushed back. Wait a second. No, the monument signs.
But they'll just be ugly
back.
Further away. Is the Nissan sign any less ugly if it's right near the right of way versus if it's set back 100 feet or 200 feet?
One thing you might want to do. I mean, we have some live examples of some of these right here in the community. I mean, the Nissan sign is down on the. On the bypass, not on the bypass, but on the 16, and it is considerably shorter.
Yeah.
But you know, you should go by and take a look and see what that does for you. Another newer sign, actually, that's along the lines of Waldron Crossing, is out to Heritage Crossing. Is that what we call it? Heritage Common.
The Walmart sign?
No, Heritage Common just beyond
the
Fire Station
Birch.
2, the old White Birch.
Okay, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, go by that and see how you like that. It's along the same theme with a lot of panel boards, and it's got a mm-hmm. peaked roof peaked. And kind of fancy-dancy, mm-hmm. but now it is mm-hmm. supposed to be 20 feet, no more than 20 feet.
Let's make them 10 feet. You know, if you push these signs towards being shorter, they're not going to have a ton of words, which makes them less ugly.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, communities do that. It's either Plastow or Haverhill. I'm not sure which it is. It's on 125, and there's got to be an ordinance there that's a 15-foot height limit because all you see exactly the same signs you see everywhere else, except they're 10 feet shorter than everywhere else. It's really interesting. It doesn't look great, but it looks a lot less intrusive than if they were 25 mm-hmm. feet tall. But if you go out to Santa Barbara, you know, and drive through Santa Barbara, there's a kind of a hoity-toity community right there. But there aren't any pole signs. It's all monument signs at the entrance to every shopping center.
Really?
Yeah. It's just, you don't see it. I mean, I'm sure people here would say, how are people going to find me? And I think that the answer out there is people find you because you have a store and people find out where the store is and they go back to the store a second time. But as opposed to just using a sign to get to a store and only going to that store once. But I think that I believe that almost every sign in Santa Barbara is like no more than 5 feet off the ground.
Mm-hmm. But then some, if I might, yeah. some store owners might say, well, then you don't get blizzards in
true.
Santa Barbara covering up your sign.
So we'll let them have 10 feet here. Eight.
But 10 feet doesn't regulate ugly, though. That's a problem. How do you regulate ugly?
Yeah.
I mean, really, you know, you
Line
look at...
Line review board.
Yeah. Well, I mean, one thing that you can get into that sign design. I mean, that's going into a whole different direction. But you know, some communities say no more than three colors per sign. I mean, that would take care of a lot of these signs. You know,
Paige? I was just unfortunately thinking of a devil's advocate issue of as much as I agree aesthetically with the desire to limit the height. Would that then encourage proliferation sort of across, in the case of a consumer square example, where we have multiple stores trying to advertise on one, you know, are they just going to create a little lineup of, since they can't, as she said, if they can't fit them so they'll be legible on a shorter sign, then will we just have more of them?
No, because you can only have a limited number per shopping center, one.
One.
I like the three color thing.
I do too. I look at that consumer square and I think if you had three colors in, well, well I'm saying make that only three colors.
It'd be better.
Does it have a different look? Absolutely.
Yeah.
But is it the zoning ordinance that you want to do that?
How else would you do it? I mean, I guess I think it has merit. It's just the enforceability is.
Why is the enforceability?
It probably wouldn't. They'd have to show you what the colors are on the application.
How many colors are in the Raleigh Springs Mall sign? And that's the one sign we liked.
Four, maybe? Four or five?
Including the letters?
It looks like some of the colors fade into other ones.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's a text issue. There's not a lot of text on that. That's why you like it.
I mean, yeah. I understand the three color thing, but I'm right. Like, man, we're really tying the artistic hands of people. We could have some nice signs that.
You're right.
It's a tough thing.
Yeah, but that's what they do in Santa Barbara. No, I'm not actually being facetious. I mean, when you go to a place like that, you just see the same thing and you get used to it.
Mm-hmm. Chris?
Though we are not a uniform planned community, much as I appreciate the aesthetics of that, I think that's probably not appropriate for us because our eclecticness, our development over time, that kind of thing. So I'm not sure that that would work for us.
Limiting colors.
Yeah, I think the height works. I'd be a little leery of the colors. Because then you're going to get into, well, why can't I do this shade of red versus that shade?
Well, no, I think, I may be misunderstood. It's any three colors.
Right, but just three.
You still get into the tones and the shades.
Okay.
And then, you know, they'll go nuts with fonts. So it's
you know, frankly, if I'm a business person, just tell me the regulations and then let me do what I can do within that. I don't think it's in zoning to put everything into a tight box.
Well, you know, if you think about some of these signs, like if the Nissan sign in the bottom left there, if it was only 8 feet tall, 10 feet tall, it wouldn't be anywhere near. It looks like there's a monolith.
Right.
And Consumer Square, if that had a height limitation and it just had a sign that said Consumer Square, you could make a really nice classy sign.
But the problem with that is then you don't know who's in the shopping center.
The idea
and
is
you really need to know on the road as you're driving down who's in that shopping center.
Who's going to see Radio Shack or
something? But the thing is you recognize the corporate logo, so you may not be able to read the letters, but you go, okay, that I understand that kind of texture from a distance. That's Circuit City, and that's where I want to go. And they may be tucked back and around the corner, say like a shopping center like Pick and Pay, where there are stores that are tucked around the back. You wouldn't see the sign on the front of the store, and you're driving down Islington Street, and you go, oh, okay, they're in that plaza. And I think it's important to have all the signs at the entrance to a shopping center, so you don't have multiple signs, or you don't have monument signs, and I think we strive to do that. Vaughan Mall, they just organized that whole signboard there, so it would identify all the businesses down on Vaughan Mall, because otherwise, how would you know they're there?
But I think there's a difference between Vaughan Mall and a shopping center. I mean, picture this consumer square, a whole bunch of these signs, you know, down Route 1 versus, you know, just
picture Fox Run Mall with all the tenancies out there. You won't see that. You go to Fox Run Mall, and then you go to your particular store. And to me, a consumer square is your destination, and then you go to the other places that you want to go. My store is in Consumer Square.
I agree. I just think it's too many signs is too much of a good thing.
One thing we might think about doing is establishing keeping the height limit that we have, and establishing a total sign area that includes every part of the sign, including the supports. So you could either have a tall pole sign or a short pylon sign. Mm. If you know what I mean, you'd either measure the whole rectangle of the pylon sign, and that would force them to be down to 10 feet maybe.
Right.
Or if you wanted to do a pole sign, you could get up to 20 feet but you just include the area of the support.
So anything that's freestanding, you would
is
include
included in the area.
Yeah.
All the
mm-hmm.
area.
Yeah.
Do you have a minimum and a maximum?
Well, we have a maximum of 20 or 25 feet for the total height.
20, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. And then we would have a we have just think what the maximum
square footage
would be. Right. That makes sense.
That's good.
Getting back to the consumer square, is that considered an address, like 100 Lafayette Road? Or consumer square, is that interchangeable? And does consumer square is not advertising any particular business in there? It's just advertising a destination. So does that count towards the signage, or is it an address?
And that should be qualified.
Yeah, because we've got that problem already. So there are things that are known by their address or by the name of the building, Plaza 800, Franklin Block.
Market. Yep. Got it.
Okay, I think this is a good direction.
I'm a little confused. Can you rehash where you think we are right now?
I think we're saying that we'd like to get smaller, generally a smaller sign, but we could work with the current height limits, work within the current height limits, but measure all parts of the sign. Right now you don't measure the pole.
Supports.
The supports. Yep. So we would measure somehow come up with a way to measure the horizontal, you know, the round supports. You have to come up with a way to do it, but it'll probably just be the diameter of the round support. But include that in the total sign area that's allowed, so that somebody could either go up high on a pole or go down, or stay down low with a monument or a pylon.
If they're down low, though, we still like the idea of pushing it back from...
Set back from the road.
Okay.
Both sides?
Both what?
Both sides count?
Both sides would count in a two-sided sign.
Oh,
yes.
Square footage.
Yes. I'm sorry. Each side, a two-sided sign counts as if it were one-sided.
A two-sided sign counts.
If it's less than what? There's some angle, 17 degrees or something like that, then it counts. You only count one side of the sign.
Okay.
Because you really can only see one sign.
Right. And it's not allowed to revolve.
So what?
It's not allowed to revolve.
No.
Or sing or dance.
All right.
Flash.
The size of the sign is the length by the width, correct?
Well, that's now we need to think about that, because we're not. Then we would be no longer talking necessarily about a single rectangle enclosing the sign.
Right, because she said the consumer square is an address. Right. How does that play in if we're just talking the volume of the sign?
Right, we're going to have to use rectangles. Now there's an example that I have from somewhere else that actually used multiple rectangles to include sign areas. So if you had an L-shaped sign, you'd include just those rectangles. You wouldn't have to do the whole thing. That's what we were talking about last time, is trying to allow something to be more creative. And so we'll try to come up with a different way to measure the sign area now that we're including some supports as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
That's good.
Yep. Makes sense, Tony.
Okay.
And is it the sense that we are not going to do anything with limiting colors or text or anything like that?
Yes, we will not limit.
Okay.
Just point out that with we're dealing with the shopping centers, we are using the plural on the signs. Yet above on uses above the ground floor, we could go back to the singular. So we just need to either be aware that we might be dealing with multiples in one case and singular in the other.
Okay. Okay, so now we have, let's just continue on then. I think we're still on page 13, but I think we're about to turn the page. Yeah. So we have one freestanding sign at the site's primary driveway, and then we have the standards. So now here we are at the freestanding signs. And we had a primary site entrance and a secondary site entrance. So if you had a shopping center in this case with two driveways, one driveway on Main Street, one on the side street, or even two on the same street, you could actually have two freestanding signs, one at each driveway, but one would have to be smaller. And these setbacks from property lines, 25 feet, does that seem reasonable? Oh.
It's 20 feet now, I think. Is it, Rick? 20 feet?
Mm-hmm. 20
feet.
Except in business, it's 7.
Yeah. Now, on this would be a primary site entrance. Consumer Square would be a primary site entrance sign.
Mm-hmm.
And it could be 150 square feet, 25 feet in height. And what would it have on it if it couldn't have the multiple sign of businesses on it?
Are you regulating?
You could have.
Well, I thought you could.
You could.
You
could
have.
I thought we were saying we couldn't have.
No.
No.
You can fit it.
We moved
just
away from
area.
That.
Oh, okay.
That was my silly idea.
Oh, okay, good.
I didn't like it.
But you want to, but keeping with your idea, is the 25 feet too high? Do you want to bring it down to 20?
Shorter is better. It's my motto.
Yeah, because we're going up in height now.
Right.
Yeah. If you want to come down,
actually,
that means...
Actually, the current regulation is 25 feet to the property line.
On a shopping center, multi-use? Yeah. The rest of the signs are 20 feet then.
Whoops.
Shopping center.
Oh, okay.
Regular signs are 20 feet.
Yeah. So do we...
all right, never mind then. Strike.
Wait, are you guys talking about the same thing, height and distance from the property line?
Height. We were talking height most recently.
Are we lowering it?
I was incorrect. I was referring to just a regular, ordinary site sign.
So in terms of height, what should we do, 20?
I'd vote for 20.
Yeah.
I'd vote for 10. But.
What are the heights that we're using on light fixtures?
16, right? Oh, you mean?
We've got some 24s and we've got some... several that are less than that.
Aren't dark sky friendly lighting 16?
But the new ones, I mean, in this ordinance.
And the site review regs, or do we have them in here?
No.
No. Why don't we look at coordinating it with that?
Because that's good.
Are you talking about the single set light?
Pole light on it.
16 feet is dark sky friendly, I believe.
We'll check.
Is it in here?
See how to coordinate it.
In site review.
That's right.
It's a good idea.
That's a very good idea.
Would it be 16 for both, or whatever the distance height is for both? Or do we want to have? I think you want to have the primary bigger. I mean, just.
I don't mind the primary bigger than 16. I think 20 sounds fine for a sign height.
We want to tell the public we prefer you come in this way. So I think.
And then maybe do the other one at 16.
I think too that we may vary though. In some circumstances, the 16 may be right, but in others, it may be better to have fewer fixtures and a little more height versus a lot of smaller fixtures and less height. I think we better check the site review on that. But it's really, what do you want the sign to be? And I think we were moving towards a reduction in height, but probably more than 15.
Okay. Okay, let's try to move ahead quickly. I think we can just get through the next two pages, and we don't need to go through all the definitions. We'll keep working on those. So there were wall signs, and this is an area in the current ordinance where there is a distinction between shopping centers that are larger than 30,000, or an establishment is larger than 30,000 square feet versus one that's smaller, and the sign area is based on distance from the building to the front lot line. So you have a larger sign if you're further back. I'm not sure that we necessarily want to keep that that concept, but I don't know if anybody had any feelings about that. It's kind of hard to imagine when you don't have a picture, I think, sometimes some of these areas. So it may help when we do a next draft to have the area, example areas of signs. But we'll be getting rid, in the next section, we'll be getting rid of the outlot building sign, the monument thing, because we'll just add that to the whole, the same, we'll have this, no distinction between the different types of monument signs. Marquee signs, we, as I mentioned before, we really want to add awning signs to this. It's basically just saying, you know, what the lettering is, and it's just included in the sign area. It's just very minimal regulations. And then we have the historic district regulations, which are carried forward from the existing ordinance. And I don't have any reason to change any of those unless there has been any experience with those two provisions.
Tony, did you have a question?
Can you help me again? What's the marquee sign?
It's like what used to be in front of Eagle Photo.
Thank you.
Can you help me with the first sentence of point two under marquee? How else would the letters be placed other than around the outside face?
It'd be sitting on top of it like a roof sign.
Ah.
Okay. Is the Ioka naturally like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
Exactly.
It is.
It's close. It's kind of cool.
No.
Okay, yeah, right.
Something like that.
Mm-hmm. Were we going to add something about also it might require additional approvals, or is that going to just be understood?
What additional approvals?
License or easements.
Easements over sort of the same thing with the projecting. Do we want it? I thought we said we were just going to, that was already being taken care of because it.
Because we had it in one spot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess just.
I'll check to make sure.
What's the problem with a marquee having sign letters above the roof? I don't mind the Ioka sign.
We don't allow roof signs.
But as long as it doesn't go higher than the roof of the building.
Yeah, it might not, well, it still could be a, you know, freestanding. It wouldn't necessarily be nice letters sitting on top of the sign. It depends what you want. The awning idea is that the letters are vertical to the street, and that's the same idea with the awnings with the marquee sign.
Could you rework point 20 into a positive instead of a negative regulation?
That's good.
Thanks.
Got it.
Were you? If I might again, we're going to add something in there about no internally illuminated signs in the historic district.
We have that under illumination. I think we had that previously. Yeah, it's on page 10, and we changed it. It was 10.1063. And it all has to do with the illumination section. We changed the wording last week just to say signs in the historic district shall not be internally illuminated, notwithstanding the provisions of Table 5.
Should we do a cross-reference there on page 15 back that? Because if you're in the historic district, just so you know, this isn't the only thing.
Yeah.
Because it might be just saying any lighting, go back to that section.
Right, that's what I mean by cross-reference, just that sends
doesn't
you to
mean
the
to say no or yes, just
right.
Go back.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. I think we can probably wrap up this here. Temporary signs, all we have here, we've got the temporary signs, which are the new business signs that are for businesses to use while they're waiting for arrival of permanent signage, and we have special event signs. And we talked before about a longer time period for these than 7 days. Yeah,
we did.
Yeah. What did we say?
We need to take a look at the staff level at the temporary and see if it's being consistently used throughout the document.
Yeah. Right, you mentioned that last time, right?
Not.
Okay.
Any other questions on temporary sign, Tony, and then Chris?
Special event signs. My preference would be to delete 21. And also give a little bit of time after the event. And my reason being is that the community seems to grab onto events that happen in the city, and signs are put up all over to promote it, film festivals and stuff like that. So I don't see a problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
We have other events in the city, and then, I mean,
I'd like maybe a definition of removed after the event, maybe like, you know, a month after the event or something like that, or a week, a day. I don't know, but.
What is it for political signs, 48 hours? No, I mean.
2 weeks. It's 10 days, I think.
I think it's 48 hours, isn't it? I think it's relatively short. Maybe keep it consistent. Consistent with that?
I think the consistency is a good idea. I think it's a longer period than that, though, just to,
whatever it is, but yeah. I'm saying be consistent with.
I guess the bigger thing I mentioned is 21. What are people's thoughts on that?
Yeah, I marked that, too. I don't, the still one doesn't make any sense to me why we would have that, because the whole idea of promotion is not to do it in one place.
It also depends on the type of sign. If they're just putting a, you know, a white paper that they write, I mean, those get tattered and torn and look like, you know, they can look pretty bad in a short amount of time.
I mean, special event signs, if, say, Kmart's having a sale, do you want Kmart signs all over town? I mean, and that's what I think that's meant to avoid. You could be wrong. If they're having some special sale, you know, going out of business, extra merchandise. If, if you took out 21, does that mean if I work for Kmart, I can go stick signs all over the place? I mean, typically, signs are only allowed on your property or if you get permission from the city to put it on city property.
And are open houses, real estate open houses, considered special events?
Depends whose eyes are looking at it.
In other words,
that's a good point, though.
Do you have to go get a sign permit for your Sunday open house?
Well, the sign would be part of the property.
Part of the property.
Anthony, did you have a comment?
Just if you're establishing a time limit by which they have to be removed, you may have to amend the definition, too, because it, by definition, can only be for a seven-day period.
Yeah, I think that the some of the stuff that was in the definition was carried forward here, and we need to make sure that we don't say it in two different places.
We look at the time, Tony.
Back to the 21. Let me cite a specific example and see. I was curious what the interpretation would be. The New Hampshire Film Festival is held about like six locations. Are all locations part of the event, so they could put signs up at all six? Is that
where this reads it would be?
Okay.
Chris, did you have a question?
Well, it's back on the historic district, so if there's more sign stuff, more special event stuff, people should do that.
Maybe if I could say, we have a work session next week, too. Maybe we should just, I'm sorry, the
it's
week
Thanksgiving.
After. Thanksgiving. Isn't everybody going for Thanksgiving? I'll bring the turkey. The week after, maybe we should wrap
temporary
it up.
Signs. Yeah, we'll pick back up on temporary signs. Do you want to take like a minute break, get a stuff up on the big table, and then I'd like to start in a couple minutes. 1 minute. Good evening. I'd like to welcome everybody to tonight's regular meeting of the Portsmouth Planning Board for November 20th. Getting right into the agenda, we're going to read in the approval of the minutes from the September 25th, 2008 Planning Board work session. Do I have an approval for those minutes?
I'll move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Approval of the minutes from the October 16th, 2008 Planning Board meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. The final approval of the minutes is the approval of the minutes from the October 23rd, 2008 Planning Board work session.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. What I would like to do is indulge the board if we could take item F out of order for the purposes of postponement.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. I'll now read it in. The application of Home Depot, owner and Paul Long Jr. applicant, for property located at 500 Spalding Turnpike, wherein amended site review approval is requested to add an 8-foot by 18-foot mobile coffee kitchen trailer to be located adjacent to the existing building with related paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 238 as Lot 20 and lies within a general business district. The board action in this matter has been deemed to be quasi-judicial in nature. If any person believes any member of the board has a conflict of interest, that issue should be raised at this point or it will be deemed waived. David, do you have any information on this?
Only that Home Depot requested that this be postponed, and I believe negotiations are continuing between Home Depot and Mr. Long.
So to a time indefinite?
In time indefinite.
Okay. Do you have a motion for postponement?
So moved.
Seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Now getting the first item under public hearings is item A, the application of Aquila Chase and Marcia N. Chase, owners, for property located at 71 Baycliff Road, and Stephen J. Little and Rosemary Golini, owners, for property located at 82 Driftwood Lane, wherein final subdivision approval for a lot line revision is requested between two lots having the following. Lot 42 is shown on Assessor Plan 207, decreasing an area from 24,695 square feet to 24,618 square feet, with 71.20 feet of continuous street frontage on Driftwood Lane. And Lot 46 is shown on Assessor Plan 207, increasing an area from 12,203 square feet to 12,280 square feet, and with 27.75 feet of continuous street frontage on Baycliff Road, and lying in a zone where a minimum lot area of 15,000 square feet and 100 feet of street frontage is required. Said properties are located in a single residence B district and are shown on Assessor Plan 207 as lots 42 and 46. Plat plans on file in the Planning Department office and is identified as Plan 020208. The board action in this matter has been deemed to be quasi-judicial in nature. If any person believes any member of the board has a conflict of interest, that issue should be raised at this point or it will be deemed waived. ML, you'll be sitting as an active member. Norm, you'll be the first alternate. So with that being said, who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Attorney Lynn Morse from Exeter. I was before you with Mr. Chase on June 19th, at which time we presented the proposal for a lot line revision on a preliminary basis. And as the notice indicates, this involves two properties. I represent Aquila and Marcia Chase, the owner of the property at 71 Baycliff Road. Attorney Bernie Pielich, who's here this evening, represents Stephen Little and Rosemary Golini, the owners of the property on Driftwood Lane. And we have basically worked out a lot line adjustment subject to your approval that will resolve issues of driveway and parking encroachment that have existed going back several owners. If you look at the plan that we've submitted this evening, the final plan, you'll see that there are areas of the driveway serving the Little and Golini property that cross a corner of the property that is by deed the property of Mr. and Mrs. Chase at 71 Baycliff Road. There's also a small encroachment of the parking area, and It's really to the benefit of both of these owners if they're permitted to adjust the boundary line, to exchange deeds that will then cause the common boundary line to be relocated so that there are no further encroachments. There's a second beneficial reason to approve this, and if you look at the area that's adjacent to the residence on the Bay Cliff Road property, my client's property, we're able to increase the setback from 2 feet to 8 feet by adjusting the boundary line. And this, in fact, was a setback that was approved in 1999 by the Board of Adjustment and was granted to a prior owner. However, it became apparent that there was an error in that plan, and there never was an 8-foot setback, but there will be if you approve and we're allowed to record this plan and to complete the exchange of small parcels. Is this an area where the minimum lot size is 15,000 square feet per lot? Mr. and Mrs. Chase's property will be slightly larger. It'll still be non-conforming, and the Little and Galini property, while slightly smaller by, I think, less than 100 square feet, will still be conforming. So we're not creating any area or any property that is worse. I think this is beneficial to both parties, and we would ask that you approve it. There were issues when we were before you in June that we sought to resolve. We've had a number of meetings with Mr. Holden. I think that this plan is one now that will meet with the city's approval, and we would ask that you give it your approval, subject to Mr. Holden confirming and approving the Mylar, which we will provide to him after tonight's meeting. So I'm happy to answer any questions that any of you may have.
Any questions of the applicant? Councilor Dwyer?
Just want to be clear that the note that's added, meaning and intending to connect Bay Cliff Road through to mean low water, that resolves the issue related to whether this is a city street and the issues that were present in May and June.
Yes, that's correct. That would be resolved on that basis. This would be the city, I think, as the note we added to the plan after some discussions with Mr. Holden and Attorney Sullivan, that this would be to the low water line, and that would be an extension to Bay Cliff Road, and it would be city property.
And even by way of further answer, in the memorandum that we gave you, it isn't quite marked, but on page 2, where it says decision of the board, paragraph starting regarding these conditions all will need to be completed. That's an up-to-date report. And if you go to the third page of that, the key bullet is the second one, or rather the it's the extension of Bay Cliff Road. And there is a meeting that was held with the Board of Adjustment, and there will need to be another meeting, but those are those issues being resolved. That is the direct response to that problem.
Any other questions for the applicant? Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll now open up the public hearing. If anybody in the public would like to speak to, for, against the application. Second time, to, for, against. Third and final time, seeing no one rise, I'll now close the public hearing.
I would just advise the board that the city attorney, Lucy Tillman, and myself were present for a non-meeting with the Board of Adjustment. The department's recommendation is not changed from that meeting, so we would recommend that you grant final subdivision approval. Once again, the primary condition, everything will have to be resolved before it is filed, but we're comfortable and confident that this is representing the city's best interests and also the interests of the parties that are involved. So we would recommend it.
Thank you, David. Yes.
I'd make a motion to approve of the three stipulations with one editorial comment that we delete the word "and" at the end of stipulation number 3 so there's, and put a period there just so there's no confusion that something additional might have been there.
Okay. Second. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I have a, I guess, a question about the next applicant. I have to recuse myself for item C, but item C is tied to item B in some respects.
We're going to read them in together as one.
Okay, then I'll recuse myself for both.
Yes. With the board indulge, I'd like to read applications B and C together and applications D and E together. Do I have a motion for that?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. I'll now read in public hearing B and C. I'll read them in together. They'll be voted on separately. Norm, you'll be an active member for this as well. Item B, the Portsmouth Planning Board, acting pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 12-G:13 and Chapter 500 of the Pease Development Authority Subdivision Regulations, will review and make a recommendation to the Board of Directors of the Pease Development Authority regarding the following. The application of Two International Group LLC applicant for property located at 75 New Hampshire Avenue, wherein preliminary and final subdivision approval is requested to reconfigure three existing lots into two proposed lots as follows. Adjust lot line between lot 1 and 2 with no change in square footage. 2. Eliminate lot line between lot 2 and lot 4 so that the proposed lot totals 604,695 square feet with 899 feet of street frontage off New Hampshire Avenue. Said lots lie within the business and commercial district where a minimum lot area of 5 acres and 200 feet of street frontage is required. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 306 as lots 1, 2, and 4. Plat plans on file in the Planning Department office and is identified as 11-01-08. Item C, the Planning Board, acting pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 12-G:13 and Chapter 400 of the Pease Development Authority Site Review Regulations, will review and make a recommendation to the Board of Directors of the Pease Development Authority regarding the following. The application of Two International Group applicant for property located at 81 New Hampshire Avenue, wherein site review approval is requested for the construction of a two-story, 27,300 square foot footprint daycare facility with related paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 306 as Lot 3 and lies within the business and commercial districts. The board actions in both of these matters has been deemed to be quasi-judicial in nature. If any person believes any member of the board has a conflict of interest, that issue should be raised at this point or will be deemed waived. Who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the board, my name is Bernie Pelich, attorney from Portsmouth. I'm here on behalf of the applicant. With me this evening is Dan Plummer, one of the principals of Two International, Maria Stoll from the PDA, Michael Mates and Dirk Rodenhaus from Hoyle Tanner, the site engineers. This project was reviewed, the site plan review portion of it was reviewed extensively by Technical Advisory Committee at their last meeting, and in reviewing the 8 pages of minutes, it was certainly evident to me that Technical Advisory Committee gave close scrutiny to the project. This is rather unique in that you have two applications, and we're really talking about a parcel at Pease, which is ultimately going to be something in excess of 20 acres and have numerous buildings on it. The proposed use for the daycare center is certainly a needed use and a use that's in the public interest. I think that, as Dirk and Michael Mates will tell you, all of the issues and the stipulations that have been placed upon this recommendation by the Technical Advisory Committee have been satisfied. As recently as yesterday, I was in contact with the city legal department working out the issue of the water services, and I'm pleased to say that I think all issues have been dealt with and I think resolved. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dirk Rodenhaus from Hoyle Tanner, who can go through the list of stipulations along with his cohort, Michael Mates, and if you have any questions, we'd be happy to try to answer them for you.
Thank you. Good evening. Dirk Rotenheis with Hoyle Tanner, engineer record on the project. And what got passed out to you essentially was the first part of the approval, which would be the subdivision approval. It's a smaller sheet, 8.5 or 11 by 17. That's only modified in a small way in a note, in a clarification. Primarily what we're doing is eliminating a lot line between lots 2 and lots 4. And we're combining those two lots, which would be a total of 13.33 or 88 acres. And in doing so, we're changing the lot line between lot 2 and lot 1 so that lot 1 would always remain in the same area, square footage area, acreage area, so as not to affect the lease, which is a current lease at 50 International. So the first part of the approval is the consolidation of two lots. And the project itself, I can jump in where it is located. It's on the trade port and in a location where was previously discussed is called the Megaplex, which was a idea for a large development of a building on essentially 20 acres, which was encompassing these three lots that are there. 75 International, or 75 New Hampshire, was a recent building that was just constructed and was approved by the board and construction completed. The location is in the area of the old gymnasium, which we're proposing a daycare facility in the same approximate location of the footprint of the daycare facility, or the existing gymnasium will be the daycare facility. I was just showing here is the basic aerial plan showing the site location relative to the trade port, and it's surrounded by Market Square, Manchester Square, sorry, International Drive and New Hampshire Avenue. The lot line adjustment is going to take place, as I mentioned, between lot 2 and lot 4. And what that does is incorporates 75 New Hampshire, which is the fairly new building that was constructed. It's here. And this is the lot here that will be consolidated with a lot that's up here. This lot is a little over 5 acres. This lot's a little over 8 acres. Combining these lots together makes approximately a little over 13 acres. The remaining lot is this one at the corner. That is has a currently occupied building, address of 50 International Drive. And it has parking completely on the site and a building a little over 28,000 square feet, and it's fully occupied currently. As I mentioned, the existing site had the gymnasium building on it, and what you see in here is this red location, and that's the proposed daycare facility. And it's essentially is in the same footprint as the existing gymnasium was. That gymnasium was demolished, as well as the tennis courts. There were some impervious tennis courts up in this upper area here. Those were all removed to allow redevelopment of these parcels. And the proposed daycare facility is a two-story, 27,300 square foot, two-story facility. The front location, the front facade of it is a one-story, and the back side of it goes to two stories. The zoning here is a business commercial district, which is an allowed use, and the existing conditions of the site also includes some wetland area that had been flagged within a year, and the whole development is respecting that for the current buffers. The proposed use of the child care facility will be up to 250 children. and that's a infant pre-K primarily, and Wendy Monroe from the facility owner is here if there's any specific questions regarding use or operation of that. The site still has some remaining pavements on it. Those will be removed as a part of the project, and by consolidating these lots, we will meet the appropriate setbacks for the facility. There are two exterior play areas that are fenced, and one in this location on the lower side, and then there's another location on the upper side. And those play areas are fully fenced. If you could pass out that parking stuff. I'm going to jump into some parking areas. The parking is located immediately in front of this facility, where we have a total of 22 parking spaces, right, that will be brand new to the facility. There is 50 parking spaces required, based on the requirement of one stall per five children. And with the total anticipation or total build out, maximum of 250 children, there would be 50 spaces required. Why are we showing 22 spaces to be newly constructed? Well, we're planning on sharing parking spaces with an underutilized parking lot adjacent to it. So we'd be installing 22 parking spaces new, and then we would have 16 spaces reserved at the 50 International site, which is adjacent to it. And that would have 38 spaces dedicated to the facility. And there would be, thanks, Bernie. So the handout, I'm just kind of going through what was just handed to you in this color coding system, is really looking at a shared parking space usage. The parking area at 50 International would be, it's underutilized now. It has about a 50% utilization in the parking lot, and the building is currently fully occupied and tenanted. So it's a very underutilized parking area. And we propose 16 reserve spaces. And then we would estimate a little over 50 spaces would be available for shared parking throughout the whole parking lot, giving it quite over the required space. Now, in order to facilitate this, we would have an easement, an access easement, and that would be written onto the recorded plan. So in all, we've got 38 spaces dedicated to the building use right at the startup. 50 spaces would be available in a shared parking with 50 International building. And then we also have included, if needed, an area where 28 future spaces could be built on site, so that the full site and the full 50 spaces could be required, could be built on the site. We don't intend to do that. We'd like to use parking spaces that have been out there for a while and they're underutilized. So we don't want to increase a lot of pavements where we don't have to. There's kind of, you know, site sustainability here that we would like to use as practices, and shared parking is one of those. There is a requirement and stipulation from TAC, because we did present a shared parking use at TAC, and the stipulation was that a trigger be established of when would you need that future parking. So on the plan that we passed out, there is some trigger language that we did go through, coordinated with city staff, and we coordinated with PDA, with Maria Stoll, and it seems that this would suffice everybody's needs and protect everybody if they did find there was non-compliant parking in that area, parking on grass or anything like that. It's in the purview of the PDA to go and review that, and
then this would provide a mechanism for them to then instigate or initiate parking, new parking to be installed if needed. There was another stipulation that took a little bit of working, and that was with the water service. And I think this afternoon we came to a conclusion and a resolution that the water service to the building, because of the ordinance of one service per lot, it would be accommodated by a second service, which would feed the daycare specifically. There's already a service provided for 75 and a service provided off for a small building over here that Bayring occupies. And by the consolidation of this lot, we would have to add an additional service connection to the water. There is an ordinance that doesn't allow that, only one service per lot. But I think through coordination with legal and PDA that it is allowed, and that's will be allowed in this case. A couple other utility items I do want to mention is we are connecting up to municipal sewer through a sewer that was installed for the 75 New Hampshire Avenue site, so that'll be on-site connection. We won't have to cut into the roadway for that. And that's just, it'll be a gravity connection and not a pump situation. The electric will be run underground through a sector cabinet. We've coordinated that with PSNH for provide service into a transformer. And the site lighting will be dark sky friendly. And landscaping and surrounding area will be in keeping with the rest of the buildings and the rest of the P's in the development. The newer buildings all have specific landscaping requirements, and there's a landscaping plan that we've reviewed with city staff, and they've at TAC level and seen that that's very adequate for this facility. Traffic, we've estimated some traffic trip generation to the site. And usually when we do that, we use some codes, some Institute of Transportation Engineering codes. And when we go into the data set for that, they do have a land use code specifically for daycare facilities. Most of those are approximately 4,000 to 6,000 square foot daycare facilities with only about 20 to 30 children. So this really isn't in the data set that fit the land use code there. They would be estimating, if I extrapolate it out of their equation, we'd have about 157 peak hour trips. It seems high, and maybe it's realistic, but we've recommended that counts be done after the facility is occupied to confirm that. I guess that really concludes the short part of my presentation. So if there's any questions, happy to answer them.
Questions to the applicant? Ms. Roberts?
Yes, I had a question about play area. It was an area of significant discussion at the Technical Advisory Committee meeting regarding the location of the play area adjacent to the wetland. There was specifically interest in adding some kind of underdrain or something to mitigate that issue, and just wondering if you can comment on that.
Yeah, we've added some under drains to that lower area to keep that play area dry. So we have added some under drains to that.
Okay, so the plans have been updated to reflect that?
Yes. Yeah, and that was a stipulation in the TAC that we did that.
Thanks.
Councilor Dwyer?
Yeah, a couple questions. Revisiting the parking, which again was quite a discussion, and I'm looking at the new map that you pointed out to us. I didn't hear you say this, but I see it on the map, which is that in the solid green area, that is reserved parking. So you do intend to mark that for staff parking. Is that the idea for the daycare center?
That's correct. We will have that area signed, and it is shown on our site plans with signage for employees. For the daycare facility, and that's done through a
an agreement with PDA, who has a leasehold on that parcel.
Well, and then a follow-up there. You mentioned that it would be infant and preschool care, and the ratios for infant and preschool care of adult to children suggests to me that you'd have many considerable number of staff. So I'm wondering what the intention is if we're reserving for parents the blue space. What's our intention for where all those other staff will park?
We have signed and dedicated, I believe it's 11 spaces for child drop-off. And those are located in this parking lot in the closest proximity to the doorway to make it easiest for that to happen, to the drop-off to happen.
And so that's 11 of the 22 that are in blue.
Yes, that's 11 of the 22 are dedicated as 10-minute loading zone, 10-minute loading, unloading, or kid loading, kid unloading. And then the remaining spaces could be utilized for faculty, for staff. And then the intent there is to have the reserve spaces, which is located adjacent to it in the existing parking lot, be utilized for staff. And then there's any other spaces beyond the reserved parking spaces into a shared capacity into the 50 for staff also.
And can I ask the estimated number of staff?
I probably would have to defer to Wendy Monroe, which I could do that.
Can you come up to the microphone, please? And just give us your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Wendy Monroe. I'm the executive director of Great Bay Kids Company. At any given time, there would be about 40 to 42 staff members on site.
Yeah, Wendy, I think there may be some questions.
Oh, just curious, I'm more familiar with how parents drop kids off at school. And I know that's always a challenge because everybody comes at once. Maybe if you can just talk a little bit how your familiarity with drop-off of different age groups, how that works and how that impacts the traffic flow out front.
Mm-hmm. The center opens at 6:30 in the morning. We currently have two centers that we operate this way, and they close at 6 p.m. So parents are dropping off their children anywhere between 6:30 and 9 a.m. So there's, you know, a steady flow, but there's not an overflow of parents all at one time, because they're all coming at different times. And the same thing in the afternoon when they're picking up, there's general pickup time from 4 to 6. So it's an open time frame for parents to come and drop off their children and pick them up. So it's not, everybody's not going to be there at 8 o'clock in the morning dropping their child off.
Mm-hmm. And will you allow people, do people have to park and bring their kids in, or will you allow people to just pull up to that front entry in the travelway?
No, there's no drop off like that. They do have to come in according to state licensing standards. They do have to come in to the classroom and sign their child in, and the same thing in the afternoon. They physically have to come into the building and sign their child out on a sign in sign out sheet.
And then sort of a related question, but not really. In the event there was some issue where you needed to get all the kids out of the building or off that site in a hurry, are there any state requirements, or just as a matter of business practice, do you have an emergency response plan or an emergency evacuation plan, anything like that?
We don't currently for this facility as of yet, but we do for our other facilities that we utilize using buildings close by. In Exeter, there's a church close by that we would go to, and in Newmarket, within walking distance, there is a public facility.
Would you have any concerns if we, as a board, added a stipulation to the approval to work with the city police and fire folks and public works to develop an emergency response evacuation plan?
Absolutely not. Great. We are actually part of the Seabrook evacuation plan over in our Exeter mm-hmm. facility.
That was
as
a
well.
Drill. All right. Thank you.
Ms. Geffert?
This just goes to parking, and it has more to do with the site review. I'm concerned that the way these parking spaces are configured, parents are going to have to be walking or carrying children across mm-hmm. traffic to the door. And I'm wondering if, in terms of site review, whether you could reconfigure parking so that they were actually parking in front of the site, so they weren't crossing a parking lot. And my second issue is, I would like to understand better the ingress and egress to the site. You spoke of an easement earlier, and I'm making assumptions about where that's going to be, but I'd like to have a better sense of that. And the reason I raise it is because I've been around daycare centers, seen daycare centers, know that parents are often in hurries. And so coming onto the site, especially if they're going by parking spaces that require backing up into that right-of-way, I'm concerned about a traffic issue there, and then I'm very concerned about unloading kids and having to cross what is a trafficked area.
Well, I think the other diagram might be a little bit better to describe it. At TAC, we did go through a number of scenarios through parking and some conceptual locations of dedicated spaces for students. We met with fire, we met with police, we met with traffic and traffic, and it was requested that we provide those dedicated spaces in the location that they're shown, which is across the aisle from the doorway. The parking lot itself is offset from really internal site driveways. I don't want to call them roadways, but there's some site circulation that happens with the other buildings in that lots, the 75 New Hampshire and the Bay Ring and the 50 International, or the 50 International building. And the parking in the driveway and the drop-off is purposely offset from that, so there isn't a whole lot of traffic that goes by them, and the people that are driving by them are very cognizant that there are kids there. They're aware of it because they're dropping off their own or picking up their own. We've added a very generous aisle there of 30 feet from the parking spaces to allow some a little bit better, safer backing up or pulling in and pulling out, giving people a little bit more room to circulate through the site. There were a lot of considerations for safety and dropping off kids and picking them up that went into the site plan itself and the parking configuration. The driveways do go off into, there are a couple of ways that you can get to the site, and one is off Manchester Square, and the other one is off of New Hampshire Avenue. And those are as you describe, they're limited parking spaces along that area, so you don't park, you don't pull back into a lot of oncoming traffic. So those spaces, there aren't any, there's a few, but there aren't a lot of them along the main drive aisles. But primarily, they would be coming off of that main drive aisle into the daycare facility and being able to maneuver around in that parking lot. You all set with that?
Yes, thank you.
Ms. Hayden?
One last thing. On lot two, or not lot two, 58 International Drive, where's your easement? Just for parking, or is it for that driveway?
It's for the driveway and for parking. And while it's not indicated on the recording plan, it will be. The easement language wanted to get worked out with PDA.
Thank you. Now I'm done.
Ms. Hayden?
Just back to the parking trigger. On the plan that you gave us, the trigger says future parking lot, quote unquote, shall be installed when blah, blah, blah. Should that be more, what is meant by future parking lot? Is it future A plus future B, or is it some portion of that? Because it's kind of a two-phase thing, isn't it?
Yeah, we're showing you two-phase because we don't know how much more demand is going to be needed. And it could be all of it. If we find through an assessment with the PDA that there is a lot of cars utilizing and there's a heavy demand for parking spaces, they'll build all of it. If not, then they may build half of it. And it really just comes down to a future assessment as to what the need of that parking lot wants, it has to be.
And just getting back to the trigger thing, and this might be a question for Maria too. It says PDA should review parking demand after 50% occupancy of the facility. Is the intent to review it again at 100%, or is there a one-time review, or is the intent really to kind of monitor this over time?
The intent is to monitor it. Is the intent, at least, I don't want to speak for Maria, but when we went through trying to get this language put together, it's really, you know, once the, it's not going to be occupied 100% day one.
Sure.
So we would be able to look at it at approximately a 50% occupancy before we find that there's problems, to maybe find some indications that if there are problems, we can react to it sooner versus waiting until there's 100% occupancy.
I'm just, you know, I don't know if you want to speak to that as well, Mary, but what I'm getting at is to whether we might be able to just modify that trigger a little bit to say, you know, that it would be monitored over time as well, you know, so there wasn't a one-time monitoring and then it went away in case things at 50 International Drive change, different occupancy or...
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that, and that I think that's what I had in mind anyway, okay. That we wouldn't look at it once and forget about it, you know, and the way that we can track this will be in the lease. So that, you know, it runs with the tenancy. It's not like the site review agreement which ends, but we'll put that right in the lease that we'll be able to, you know, track it at 50% and then continue to monitor it.
So I figured that was the intent of it, to monitor over time. What would, I guess, be agreeable to you to in terms of that monitoring? Periodic, but you know, PDA shall review parking demand after 50% occupancy and periodically as needed. I mean, is that a fair approach to this?
That covers it for me, yeah, if that's clear for the rest of you. I think that's clear.
Thanks very much.
Councilor Dwyer.
Is this a situation where most of the kids are there, ask this in a different way, you know, a lot of daycare centers serve younger kids and preschool kids to a point in the afternoon, and then after school kids are added to that. Is this that kind of situation, or is this largely the situation where you won't have that kind of additional flow coming in and out?
We're planning to have infants through five-year-olds in the program. We are not planning during the school year, except for during vacations, to have any school-age children or kindergarten-age children, so there wouldn't be that type of transportation.
But during the summer, for example, you might peak up to more trips and more kids.
Right. There could be more children from age 6 to 12 in the building at that time. We have a multipurpose room down on the second floor that we're planning to have children possibly during the summertime.
Wendy, quick question. Were you all set, Councilor Dwyer?
Well, I just wondered then about the adequacy of the play areas if you're thinking of 6 to 12-year-olds, and I noticed in one place it described that they would be grass covered, and then on the landscape plan there's a note that suggests it's bark mulch.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is a requirement through the state licensing that we have absorbent material under any climbing equipment.
Okay.
So the bark mulch would be any under any climbing equipment 29 inches or higher. So that we're hoping to have a variety of things on the playground, but that would be for any what we would call a climbing structure area.
Mm-hmm. If this is maxed out at 250 children, do you have any data that indicates is how many of those 250 are siblings? Do you have an idea?
I don't currently. I can tell you that in the center that we have in Exeter, we have 94 children, and I believe about 15 of them are siblings right now.
Okay.
So it would be hard to tell until we start enrollment, but okay. Generally there would be siblings involved.
So two kids brought through one parent, I'm assuming.
Mm-hmm.
So okay.
Right.
All right. Thank you. Dirk, I just got a couple questions on the site. Had you given any consideration to pervious pavement? I know you're bringing in quite a bit of fill up front. Seemed like it would be an ideal spot for it.
Yeah, there are a couple areas. There's some pocketed wetlands around that area. And when we did some hand test pitting, there is some groundwater that we did want to be concerned, didn't want to get too far into. Yes, we could do a little bit in the filled areas. But it would have been parse. We wouldn't have been able to do a full lot there, because if we get a four-foot depth of stone, we would have potentially gotten into some of the groundwater. So we didn't want to get half and half. We took the measure of trying to reduce impervious by not putting impervious down by using combined and shared parking.
Isn't the bulk of that, though, about a 4, 5, 6 foot fill on the front? Isn't there quite a bit of fill going in the front of that? I mean, you look like you got a 74 and you've got an 82 on top of it. You got.
Yes.
Oh, that's eight feet.
Yeah, when you get over to that back, the lower side of this, the west end of it, it is in a little bit more of a fill area there. But we wouldn't have wanted to just do that on one end and not the other end. The other end, which is up towards 80, we've got some water at 74. So, you know, there's 6 feet there, but we still don't want to have a zone of influence of that water. There's a big hillside that comes down through there. The grade differential between International Drive, which is up at 90, comes down that hill pretty steep.
And what do you need for separation for pervious pavement to groundwater?
Like around 6 feet, you know. We can get it with 4 feet, but we'd like
so
to
if you had it 4 feet,
more.
Wouldn't you have the bulk of this front area?
I wouldn't.
I'm just saying it looks like a prime area. You're bringing in a lot of fill on top of an area that I know the bulk of the. Anyway, I just wanted to pose the question because I think that would be a good area to do it. But if you've looked at it and it doesn't work, then that's fine.
We've considered it, absolutely. You know, we always do now, and we always try to look at opportunities for reduction in impervious areas. We felt that this area lended itself best to the shared parking and trying to reduce the parking area footprint itself as much as possible. And some of the adjacent areas which aren't impervious, which are pervious pavements, aren't necessarily in a redevelopment stage. We could look at those ones in the future. But I think when we looked at it, the overall hillside here coming down and the groundwater essentially coming out, seeping out into the hillside upstream of this, we didn't feel confident that we'd be able to fully utilize, you know, pervious pavement infiltration practice through that. What we did do a little bit of is provide some infiltration practices at the outlet of the storm drainage. While not required, we do have a vegetated swale there, and it's elevated enough where we have some stone infiltration media underneath that. So we've got a longer swale there where we could utilize some infiltration there closer to the wetland.
All right. I'm not a big fan of point source discharges. But anyway, I made my point. I'll move. In the this middle island, there's a rectangle in there. Right near Catch Basin 2, I'm trying to figure out what that rectangle is.
Sign. Daycare sign.
Okay. And then on the very bottom, on it says end silt fence. I didn't know what that was pointing to. Is there something, I guess it's page C5. On the very bottom, it says end silt fence. I didn't see the...
Yeah, actually, the intent was to bring a piece, portion of the silt fence down to that point, although the line of the silt fence doesn't do that. We came, as a TAC comment, added a piece of sidewalk to interconnect the sidewalks with 75, so there'd be some land disturbance there. So we'd have to correct that line type and bring that silt fence down to where it does say. The arrow and note are in the right place. The line isn't.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Any other questions for the applicant? No? Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll now open up the public hearing. If there's anybody in the public wishing to speak to, for, against the application. Second time. Third and final time. To, for, against. Seeing no one rise, I'll now close the public hearing.
I think the plan won.
What I'd like to do, Board, is take these items and vote on them separately. So we will first be voting on the item B for preliminary and final subdivision approval.
Make a motion for to approve preliminary and final subdivision.
Second
with the three stipulations.
Any further discussion on the motion? Ms. Geffert.
I just have a question. You know, the easement from Manchester Square, does that have to be in the subdivision piece, or does that go into the site review piece?
Should be.
They don't need access, you know, but...
I'd recommend that it be added to the subdivision. Yeah. There should be easements, I believe, for the parking, and there should be easements for the access into the driveways.
Any other discussion on the motion? Hearing none, I'll call. All those in favor?
Aye.
With the added...
Yes.
Sorry.
And the chairman votes aye. We'll now vote on application C, which will be for site review approval. Ms. Hayden.
David, does given the water service issue and that they'll be basically being allowed that second service for the lot, does stipulation one, the way it reads, cover that? Do we need to add any additional stipulation for that? I mean, that's a that will work. Oh, would you like a motion?
I think we should have
all right, I'll make a motion before we discuss it. I would make a motion for site review approval with the 18 stipulations and adding two new stipulations. One, that the applicant work with our police, fire, and DPW to develop an emergency response evacuation plan. And the 20th stipulation should just modify the trigger for the construction of future parking so that it would read PDA shall review parking demand after 50% occupancy and add the language and periodically as needed.
And do we want to address Ms. Geffert's?
And stipulation number 21, that the easements be shown.
And stipulation 22, that they revise the silt fence line.
And stipulation 22, that they revise the silt line.
Do I have a second?
Boy. Not sure if I dare. Second.
All right. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Dwyer.
Well, one thing I just noticed is stipulation number 6 suggests that all the parking spaces on the west side are for parent drop-off, and I think in the answer to the question, we determined it was 11 that were for parent drop-off. So I think the stipulation is different than what the applicant suggested. Unless I'm not reading the stipulation correctly. But there are all of those in the blue are in that location, and I don't think they're all dedicated for parent drop-off.
And was the 11 space on the west side of the parking area.
The discussion at with Deb Finnegan in traffic was that the would be the on the west side of the parking lot that has the 21 spaces.
And you know what? The stipulation says the west side of the building, which is what why I think there's a difference. So we'd want to correct that stipulation if that was the agreement.
Yeah, we met with Deb afterwards, and we revised our site plan so that they're signed that way, and we submitted those back to her, and she felt that those were 11 spaces were what we meant by the west side.
The ones in the alley.
Yes.
It's the ones in the island that you intend, right? Not the ones closest to the building in blue.
Correct.
Okay. So the maker of the motion will ask that stipulation number 7 be amended to reflect that.
Six.
Does that address your concerns, Counselor?
Yes, just for clarity.
And now, going back to my question to David about stipulation number 1, does that is that broad enough, that's stipulation number 1 about the water service, so that can still be worked out on the
Yes, it's a process that's still in motion, but I did talk to Dave Allen, and they are working, and they think they have a resolution in sight, but it's still coming together.
So we don't need to modify that stipulation? Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other discussion on the motion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you. We will now read in, we'll take items D and E. I'll read them in together, and we'll vote on them separately. Application D, the Portsmouth Planning Board, acting pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 12-G:13 and Chapter 500 of the Pease Development Authority Subdivision Regulations, will review and make a recommendation to the Board of Directors of the Pease Development Authority regarding the following. The application of Northeast Rehabilitation Health Network applicant for property located at 105 Corporate Drive, wherein preliminary and final subdivision approval is requested with the following. Proposed lot 6A, having an area of 7.36 acres and 766 feet of continuous street frontage off Corporate Drive. Proposed lot 6B, having an area of 6.44 acres and 200 feet of continuous street frontage off Corporate Drive, and the remaining land area being decreased by 13.80 acres and constituting a portion of the trade port. Said lot lies within the business and commercial district, where a minimum lot area of 5 acres and 200 feet of street frontage is required. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 303 as lot 6. Plat plan is on file in the Planning Department office and is identified as 10-02-08. Application E, the Portsmouth Planning Board, acting pursuant to New Hampshire RSA 12-G:13 and Chapter 400 of the Pease Development Authority Site Review Regulations, will review and make a recommendation to the Board of Directors of the Pease Development Authority regarding the following. The application of Northeast Rehabilitation Health Network applicant for property located at 105 Corporate Drive, wherein site review approval is requested for the construction of a two-story, 26,175-square-foot rehabilitation facility with related paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 303 as Lot 6 and lies within the business and commercial district. The board action in these matters has been deemed to be quasi-judicial in nature. If any person believes any member of the board has a conflict of interest, that issue should be raised at this point or it would be deemed waived. Who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Good evening. Brad Mosquito from Appledore Engineering. Is it the board's wish that we take one application at a time, or would you like to see the site plan as a whole and vote on it one at a time?
We'll take both applications and read them in and present them as one, and then we'll vote on them separately.
Got it. As you can see, as part of the subdivision plan that is being proposed as part of the project, we're dealing with the land that is just to the south of Franklin Pierce College, which sits out in this area. Corporate Drive, down at the bottom of the page. This is the access drive that goes up to.
There should be a switch.
How's that?
Nope.
Yeah, that working? This is the drive up to Franklin Pierce College. If you're familiar, this is Goose Bay Drive. This is the iron lot, as they call it, which is adjacent to Lonza, which sits down here. Way over to the south beyond this wetland is the wastewater treatment plant. What is being proposed is to create two separate lots. Lot one is shown here, which is the 7.36 acre parcel that the proposed rehabilitation facility will sit on. And then as part of the project was to create a second lot for future. Nothing's being proposed on that lot at this time, but it is being broken out. That lot being 6.44 acres. I know it's a boring board, but there's nothing out there. We're all green. As you can see from the topography, there is a slope that starts up at the Franklin Pierce and does slope down in a southerly direction, down by the corner of Goose Bay and Corporate Drive. as you see in the outline, is the 7.36 acre lot that we had previously spoke of. As you can see, we're creating two entrance drives, one in this location down the southerly portion of the lot. The second will access the easement that goes up to Franklin Pierce College, which is also known as Pine Street West. Fairly simple layout. The building, we're tucking into the hill that's up in the back part of the property. It's a partial two-story building, taking advantage of the difference in elevation on the topography. Most vehicles will enter in this area. There is a drop-off area out front with an overhang or a drive under. Parking throughout, there's a whole another tier in front of it. Again, we've allowed for circulation for drop-off. There's a cut through here so you can come in, find your spaces. We have the loading area out in the rear of the property, and this drive over here to the southern portion of the building will be for ambulance drop-off. As a part of this project, the question came up in why we're showing this future lot out back is there needs to be access to gain, to get access to that rear lot. We are proposing, as shown on the subdivision plan, a access and utility easement that would use the common drive located in this location for access in the future for that lot. Out on the backside, you will see we have created a patio area. That patio area is actually located off the second floor of the building. So if you enter in the front of the building, you'd be at the ground floor, come up a story, you can exit out at a higher elevation in the back. We have proposed a stormwater collection system down in the southerly portion of the site, collecting it throughout the site with closed drainage system, and then using the new LID technology, using the gravel wetland over in this area for treatment and detention. As we had submitted, I don't know if you could direct me a little bit here. We had submitted as part of our application a complete summary of all the changes that were made to the drawings as part of the TAC comments. I don't know if it's your wish to go through those individually. We certainly can. Your discretion on that one.
Does the board want to go through them individually? I mean, I find this table very helpful, by the way.
Good.
It seems like you present them on every application. I think they work for me, so I think everybody else is nodding their head, so I think we're all set with that.
Okay. With that, let's open up to questions.
Questions for the applicant?
I had parking-related questions, I guess. specifically, numbers of spaces. I guess I just wanted sort of clarification in terms of how you came up with the numbers. I'm specifically looking at the letter from Appledore dated November 11th, in which some of that was outlined. And it talks about 40 employees and 33 beds. That's in reference to the wastewater. But
correct.
I was just thinking in terms of parking requirements, and then if that letter also notes that 150 parking spaces would be provided,
mm-hmm.
which seemed like a lot if we're only requiring 33.
Sure.
So if you can just sort of clarify that.
No, that's a good question. The requirements of 33 was a PDA requirement based on number of beds. Obviously, that number of requiring 33 is just an insufficient number. We're going to have more employees than that on site. The number was derived based on a ratio of the same facility down in Salem, New Hampshire. So we took a ratio based on number of spaces that they're currently utilizing based on their proportion of beds and scaled it back to get to here. What you'll also see, it goes into the parking count on this site, which is a little bit different than other sites, is the number of handicap spaces you see on site. Because we are deemed a rehab facility, ADA clearly specifies any rehab facility needs to have 20% of their parking spaces handicap accessible. So that's a much larger number than you're going to used to see. So that's why you see the number of spaces out there. And that number is based on 20% of the total number provided, not on what is required. Okay. So that dictates how we came up with the parking count.
So I guess a related question would be about the possibility of pervious pavement out there with that many parking spaces.
Sure. When we started this, we were actually under the impression that DES was actually going to have their new regs in place by now, which they don't. But we started in that direction as we were designing the site. As I had mentioned, the topography slopes from north to south out here. 90% of this site is in a cut section. It is an export site, so we are cutting in. The geotechnical report in the borings we've done out there, there's going to be a significant amount of ledge out there. That kind of took us out of the pervious pavement world. We started looking at other LID technologies, whether we're using rain gardens or tree filters, and we went through them all. Using the gravel wetland for filtration and detention is part of it. We're certainly doing the deep sump and oil hoods on all the catch basins, but even in addition to that, even after we treated and detained in the gravel wetland, we have a treatment swale on the exterior that would technically by itself meet today's regulations for stormwater. So as far as treatment and detention and detention, we have exceeded twice what the state would normally require.
Thank you.
Sure. Councilor Dwyer.
I have a little question and a big question. The little question is, what is the mobility park, the space that is designated as mobility park?
That area is going to be an area where people will have different textures and surfaces.
I see.
Okay, whether
practice
it's...
Practice on.
Yeah, exactly. It's, a walking track, if you will.
Okay.
Some of it might be brick pavers or pavement or bark mulch or different surfaces for them to get used to.
My bigger question, and it's probably for Ms. Stoll, and I should have asked it also related to the daycare center. I know from my efforts in attempting to address the housing possibilities at Pease that there are restrictions on the part of the Air Force related to human habitation or extended human habitation. One of the things that we understand or we have understood is that part of the restriction on housing had to do with, the nature of the site and the issues of residual danger on the site so that it wouldn't be appropriate to have people living on Pease. So I should have asked it about the daycare center, but the same thing applies around a rehab hospital and what the Air Force is thinking is around having people who might have breathing problems or whatever being on site when it's not appropriate to live there.
Well, I can tell you that our land use controls do allow daycare centers and they do allow hospital uses. And one of the first things that I did when we got this proposal was to check with the Air Force, the EPA, and DES, explained where the site was for the daycare in particular, and asked them to go through and see if they could find any reason, and they looked at the sites both here and there and had no objections to those.
So then do I understand by that their objections are not to the overall PDA but to specific locations on the trade court?
Well, in this case, where they are uses that are allowed by our land use controls, yes.
Any other questions, Councilor? Any other, Mr. Coviello? You want to pull your mic down?
Thank you. I see your response to one of the stipulations in the department memo was that you're not proposing any invasive species, but that doesn't seem to be what the department was asking. And nor would this board be asking, are there any invasive species currently on the site? And
would there be any problem if we reword that that stipulation to say that the applicant shall inspect current species and remove them if they are in there?
That's fine.
Okay.
No, that's.
And then a second question is, the gravel wetland has become a popular, and rightfully so, a means for best management practices, but there's been some difficulty in constructing them, and I think the board is not yet, I can't speak for the board, I am personally not yet comfortable that that the contractors and even civil engineers have this has become the norm in how to design with this. Has there been any review from an outside engineering engineer who specializes in these designs?
Well, certainly we've had discussions with Rob Rosine at UNH Stormwater Center, and if you're familiar, we've actually designed and installed one of these at our own building right down the street, and worked hand in hand with the contractor. It was, they're actually not that difficult once you explain the intent of what the basin is intended to do. So we certainly we have personal experience, and we've dealt with, yes, a third party of having Rob Rosine give his input on the design.
Yeah. Well, and Spickman has been toured through the site as well with Dr. Rosine. He said there has been a number of issues where they haven't been built correctly. I don't know who designed them, but I would feel more comfortable with either someone from the Stormwater Center or someone else who can be identified as an expert in this to review the design. And maybe review the constructive product. I don't know what if Peter Britz feels that he's an expert in this stuff, or
the way I would approach it would perhaps be to have the city and the PDA work out a process to ensure that it is constructed appropriately. Then we can work out a format for doing that. I think that's a good suggestion.
Yeah, I'd feel more comfortable. I'm sure they know how to design them. It's the construction really that makes the difference. So maybe have a city of Portsmouth rep there while coordinating with Appledore. I think that's probably the best way to do it.
Okay.
Any other questions for the applicant? Mr. Hopley?
Yeah. It looks like you did a very good job of trying to coordinate your site plan with the architect's building exits plan. I noticed, I think this is the first time I've ever seen a site plan that actually shows door locations on the building that coordinate with your patios and sidewalks.
Mm-hmm.
The only question I have, though, is on the northwest side of the building, where it seems we leave the building in the rear, go to the patio, and then come back in the building again, and then go back out to get to the front of the parking area. And I guess I would submit if we're leaving the building in emergency, we don't want to come back in before we get to the parking lot. Right there,
you're
right?
Speaking of those areas.
Yeah, it's a goes in and a goes outer.
Right. I mean, there were supposed to be exit doors. Are you looking for a
Well, I think
path
you need a path to go around to get, if in fact that's what's happening there, it looks like that's what might be.
The on this Lucy here. If you get over on this side over here,
yep.
We do have a wall there, so you can't bring a sidewalk around the left or the northerly side of the building.
You could build stairs.
You could. The intent here was this was going to be an exit to get back to the patio. We have a door on the lower floor. On that, that shows the exit onto this sidewalk, which would be our access to the mobility park.
Well, I guess my point is, if the building design requires exiting out of that rear because of travel distance, and now you're outside on the patio, you need to be able to get to the public way from the patio without going back into the building. So, someone needs to probably think about that. At some point, maybe you won't put doors on the site plans anymore.
We have Mike Palmer from JSA who can deal with his access issue.
Okay.
Pickup building.
I mean, I don't know, but
losing me on that one.
In the hospital construction that we're doing is typically a defend in place with smoke compartments and everything like that. We're looking for access for the mobility park for part of the training of the public and the reintegration from those standpoints. not necessarily for emergency egress from that building.
Well, okay, I'm not going to belabor it now because we'll be seeing the plans, but all I can tell you is your exit discharge ends at the public way. So if you've got a required exit on the back of the building that brings you to the to a yard, I will be looking for a way to get to the public way. So I know the defendant pays process, and that's something totally entirely different. You still have to get your exits to go to the public way. We might have a different sidewalk arrangement, but that's probably minor.
Oh, I think maybe that could even make be a stipulation. Yeah. Stipulation. Any other questions for the applicant? Mr. Coviello.
I'm sure it is, but I have to ask. Dark sky friendly lighting?
Oh, absolutely.
is by definition that the lamp that you provided, that is dark sky friendly? I mean, so
they actually use a different terminology, and I'm trying to remember what it is. They didn't use the word dark sky friendly, but they actually
the department's satisfied?
It was dark sky. We had that discussion with Dave DeFosis, but they use a different terminology, but it essentially means the same thing.
And does your site plan indicate be careful on the signage? Where the location of the signage?
We do. We show up front along the corporate drive, right at the entrance here. There is a showing a sign location. There.
Pylon sign. Great. Thank you.
It takes on a whole new meaning, doesn't it? Any other questions for the applicant? No. Thank you.
Thanks.
I'll now open up the public hearing. If there's anybody in the public that would like to speak to, for, or against the application. Second time, third and final time, 2-4 against. Seeing no one rise, I'll close the public hearing. What's your pleasure, board?
I make a motion for preliminary and final subdivision approval with the five stipulations.
Ms. Hayden brings up a good point. We'll vote on application D for final and subdivision, preliminary and final subdivision approval. So that's what we're voting on now. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second. Any discussion on the motion? No, hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. We'll now vote on application E for site review approval.
I move approval with the 16 stated stipulations and added a 17th that in the event that additional sidewalks are needed from the rear of the building, they be brought out to the parking area.
And be coordinated with planning?
That would just be a minor.
Yeah. Or just, if you indicate that that should be viewed as minor, that would make it a lot easier.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have no doubt either.
Now, I'll second it if I can get two more stipulations. One that the wording of, I guess it's a rewording of stipulation number 11, that if any invasive species are on the site currently there, should be removed. And then stipulation 18 would be that the applicant work with the department and come up with, I'm trying to think of the wording for these
evaluation.
The basin, the rock,
gravel
wetland.
That the applicant coordinate with city staff.
MPDA.
For the installation of.
Installation. Yeah.
During
of
the
gravel
installation.
Wetland.
Yeah. So fine.
During the installation.
During. Yeah. Yeah.
Just wanted to be clear.
Construction oversight.
There we go. Wordsmith.
Is that acceptable to the maker of the motion?
Yes, that's great.
Okay. Any other discussion on the motion? I'll call. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you. David, could I ask if when the applicant's getting ready for construction that maybe the board's notified so that we could see these as they're going in?
Sure.
I know we asked him to do it at the Meadowbrook, and I think that may be put on hold for a bit, it looks like.
We'll do it. We can work with Brad on that.
Just, you could just speak. I couldn't hear
just
you.
Just let us know when you're going to be constructing that gravel wetland. I think we're all interested in seeing these new LIDs and how they go in. So,
sure. And if any time. I'll open up. Hey, just if anybody wants to come over and visit the office, I'll be happy to show you one that's in place and walk you through on how it functions.
Thank you.
During a storm, right? That's when they work best.
We've already acted on application F, so we'll now go to item three, city council referrals and requests. Item A, request for a license agreement for 10 Pleasant Street for the installation of a metal and glass canopy. The board action on this matter has been deemed to be legislative in nature. If any person believes any member of the board is a conflict of interest, that issue should be raised at this point or be deemed waived. David?
I'm not sure if Mr. McNabb was planning on attending, but it is a referral. Have the department's memo on it, a brief synopsis. The handicap ramp was actually put in conjunction with an amendment to the original site plan, and it is recognized as a largely public facility. What we're recommending is now with the canopies, that we consolidate this all into one master license that would effectively recognize the handicap ramp and the both proposed canopies. Of note, the installation of the canopies has received a certificate of appropriateness from the HDC. I believe that DPW took part in a considerable amount of consideration into the installation of the ramp, but they've not had an opportunity to review the proposed canopies. And so the intent is to allow them the opportunity to review it. And of course, that would include Rick in case there was an issue. But I believe it meets all the code requirements and everything else. So we would advise you to favorably recommend this license request back to the City Council, subject to the four stipulations that are before you.
We should have a vote on that, David?
Yes. Yeah. It's not a public hearing.
No.
For the record, I will not be voting on this.
Okay. Ms. Hayden.
I'll make a motion to approve with the or to recommend this favorably to the City Council with the four stipulations listed.
Second.
Seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. We'll now move on to new business. Appointment of the CIP subcommittee. I'm going to sit on it this year, and I'm looking for 2 to 3 planning board members that would like to join me. I think it's December 17th.
December 17th. It starts with a lunch at 11:30. Nothing fancy, so you don't have to dress appropriately. And we should end about 5 o'clock or so, half hour either way.
Yep. So do I have a couple of three volunteers? Anthony and Tony and Norm, you three want to sit? Okay. Thank you. I think I've sat on it for 3 or 4 years, and the CIA, it's a great process, and the lunch is just a bonus. So.
What date is that again, John?
December 17th.
We'll be putting out a memo that'll be going to all the departments, and we'll go to you. You'll be doing this on behalf of the board. It's your recommendations that set up the initial prioritization of the CIP. And at your meeting in January, you'll be reviewing the draft CIP, and upon your adoption of it, with or without amendments or additions, deletions, that'll become the draft document that'll go to the City Council in January. It becomes a component in the city's annual budget. So it's really a good exercise.
And weren't we just given an award for CIP, I believe?
The CIP has not yet received the due recognition that I think you should get. However, the city's budget has.
Okay. Well, I knew it was something
technically
close.
Technically, it's a part of that. So.
And we were a big part of that.
Yes.
I think so.
I'll get a Xerox of that award so that we can share it.
Great. We'll move on to our last item of the night, amended site plan review. It's item A, the request for amended site review for approval for 6 to 16 Congress Street to relocate a handicap parking space in the parking level. The board action in this matter has been deemed to be quasi-judicial in nature. And if any person believes any member of the board is a conflict of interest, that issue should be raised at this point. It will be deemed waived. David, can you give
Yeah. Attorney McEachran is here, and this is a public hearing, but just so I can bring you up to the current. We received a request to verify that the requirements of the site plan were being met. We went down and viewed it with Attorney McEachran and Mr. Kelm. And the issue was that the that there was a redirecting or a reorientation of the required handicap space. So we worked out an amendment to the plan that actually moved this handicap space in closer proximity to the elevator. We agreed that that change made sense, and we agreed that we would bring it to you with the recommendation that the board should approve this site, this change to the site plan. There is considerable interest on the part of other parties, and we received the facts that we've just handed out to you now late this afternoon. We provided a copy to Attorney McEachran. I've had an opportunity to review it with the city attorney, and frankly, the issue that this board is really dealing with is whether or not the amended site plan showing where the handicap space is appropriate or not. We find it to be appropriate, and we would recommend that the plan be amended as it's being shown, and further that there is an issue that arises out of that handicap space. It may be best resolved between the private parties that are involved and doesn't properly involve the city. But having said that, the applicant has his representative here, and as much as it is a public hearing, I would encourage you to allow Attorney McEachran to speak. We need to do that at some point. So,
well, then I'll open up the public hearing now. If there's anybody that would like to speak to, for, or against.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. My name is Paul McEachran. I represent 616 Congress Street LLC, the applicant. This is a secure private parking area underneath 616 Congress Street, known now, I guess, as the Eagle Building. It's accessed only by owners of spaces. It has a secure door that requires a code. The elevator requires a code to get to that level. The space was originally located further away from the elevator. I think it was the furthest away, and it's been relocated to a handicap accessible space, which is 14 feet wide right next to the elevator. And we're asking that it be a minor change to the plan be made so that, that's the designation. All of these spaces are used by the owners of the spaces, who have to be unit owners in the building. It's not open to the public, never will be, but it nevertheless, a building of that size with that parking area has to have a handicap accessible space. It does have one.
Okay.
Thank you. Any questions?
Any questions? No. Thank you. Any first-time speakers, two, for, against? Second time speakers, two, for, against. Third and final time, I'll now close the public hearing.
What we'd look for would be a motion from the board to approve this amendment to the approved site plan.
I'll make that motion to approve the amended site plan.
Second.
I'm just reading in this letter we received.
Was this just delivered tonight, David?
Yes, you've received copies of it, and we provided copies to Attorney McEachran. You might want to describe it just so everyone will know that it is before the board.
In the essence, I'm just going to read it real quick. It's from Coughlin, Rainbaugh, Murphy, and Lound, and it's addressed to Lucy. Dear Lucy, please be advised that I am representing Nancy Gregor. Sorry if I butchered that, but Nancy is a member of 616 Congress. In addition, she is the owner of a retail space at 616 Congress. We are writing to object to the request for the Planning Board to amend the site plan in regard to the handicap parking space. I understand that the request made by letter from Palmer Keckern is to relocate the handicap space to the space closest to the elevator. We are writing to notify the board that the space closest to the elevator is number 26
and that space was sold to former Realty 2 LLC on July 8th of 2008. I attach a copy of the deed regarding this space. Therefore, we do not believe it would be proper to amend the site plan as requested. In addition, it is entirely possible that a situation could arise where an owner of a unit would need a handicapped space. Please present this letter to the board at the meeting tonight. Thank you. Very truly yours, Kenneth Murphy. So everybody on the board got a copy of that. So, Mr. Coviello.
I guess I don't mean to ask Dave to repeat himself, but I just want to see if I understand where we are in this. What we're basically saying is that this is an internal issue amongst the board members themselves, and that
yes, our requirement is to make sure that there is a required handicap space. There is one. I believe the sign might have been taken down after we saw it, and I think Attorney McEachran would indicate that it will be up and will remain up. But frankly, beyond that, it's not really an issue the city needs to be in. The parties of interest would need to take it further if they wish. So hypothetically, for example, if we got sued, it's not going to be on our dime. It'll be the interested party, which would be part of the condominium association.
That kind of clears it up for me. So
just Ms. Hayden, as a footnote, it's not really within our purview to take any action about that, right?
Correct.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would agree. So I think we had a motion and a second. Any other discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you for that clarification, David. Before we call for adjournment, any housekeeping items? Our upcoming meetings are
December 4th, 11th, and 18th. We'll be having work sessions.
We'll let you off for Christmas.
Yeah. And we will put out notices to those, but the 4th, the 11th, and the 18th. The 18th is a regular meeting. We don't have everyone here, so we can't really do the picture. Yeah, we'll give it one more.
So,
there is one other item.
Yes.
The department wishes you all a happy Thanksgiving.
Oh, happy Thanksgiving all. Does anybody on the board have any other housekeeping items before we call for adjournment? So, I would extend that too. Have a happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Do I have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Thank you. Good night.